everyone. Welcome to the first Peace and Justice Report for Pennsylvania. I'm Joyce Davis, Outreach and Opinion Editor with the PA Media Group, the parent company of PennLive and the Patriot News. And I'm delighted to welcome you to this first Peace and Justice in PA annual report. This special event will examine the state of diversity, inclusion, and equality across the Commonwealth through the perspective of the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission and through questions from you, our readers and our viewers. In addition to PA Media Group's collaboration with the Commission, sponsors for this special event are PSECU and Weiss Markets, with WITF as public media partner. We envision this as the first in a series of events examining our community's progress toward the highest ideals of social justice and equality. Chad Dion Lassiter, the Human Relations Commissioner's Executive Director, will report on its efforts during what has been a pivotal year in the fight against bias and discrimination. And we have invited as our keynote speaker, Eddie Glaude Jr., one of America's most distinguished voices on the complexity of race, religion, and democracy. But first, some words from Pennsylvania's top public servants, Governor Tom Wolf and State Attorney General Josh Shapiro, men who need no introduction.
Hi, I'm Pennsylvania Governor Tom Wolf. Welcome to the first Peace and Justice in Pennsylvania annual report. Pennsylvania was founded as a place where all people would be welcome. Well, we haven't always lived up to that ideal of acceptance and inclusion, but it certainly is a goal worth fighting for. As a Commonwealth, our diversity brings us strength. Our differences enrich our culture, our economy, our society. Hatred and discrimination have no place in Pennsylvania, and I am grateful to those who do the hard work of helping victims of hate crimes and discrimination and their families. In particular, I want to thank the commissioners and staff of the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission for their hard work to enforce non-discrimination laws, to document injustice, and to foster a culture in Pennsylvania that values acceptance and inclusion. We may not have reached our goal, but your work gets us a little bit closer each and every day. Thank you.
Well, hello, everyone, and let me say a special hello to Joyce Davis, the host today, and all of the distinguished guests. I am really sorry that I couldn't join you live tonight, but I didn't want to miss this opportunity to thank you for the work that you're doing and the important conversations that you are having here today. And I want you to know that my office is here for you, and we're actively engaged in fighting bias incidents and hate crimes. But it takes all of us working together to stop the hateful acts and abhorrent beliefs that we face. Hatred and fear of others has been built by people over generations, and it won't go away without persistent and concerted effort from all of us. Gatherings like this one, targeted interventions by my office and organizations around the state, and strong legislation put forward in our state government can make progress to stop the hatred that holds back our most vulnerable communities. Because no matter what you look like, where you come from, who you love, or who you pray to or choose not to pray to, the law must apply to each and every one of us, fairly and across the board. It's been nearly 3 years since the Tree of Life shooting. And for me, it's a stark reminder that the hate that motivates domestic terrorists in this country and in this Commonwealth still festers. My office has analysts and agents and attorneys in every region of the state. They're embedded with our partners at the local and state level. But the fact remains, there is a rising level of hate in this country. And these attacks are born out of racism, anti-Semitism, Islamophobia, and the list goes on, sadly. Last year, the Department of Homeland Security released a new threat assessment that identified violent white supremacy as the most persistent and lethal threat in the homeland. When I was elected Attorney General, it was a priority to use this office to combat hatred using all the tools available to us in the law. And for too long, that mission wasn't the priority it should have been. It is now. We knew that we needed to change, so we started to reinvigorate our civil rights enforcement section. And now we have a chief and more active than ever before with our federal and state partners. In addition, today our office looks more like the people that we represent, the people that we were sworn to serve. We had two goals, using the position of the Office of Attorney General to expand our office's understanding of bias, and then using our agency to create real external change, which is why we continue to work with our state partners like the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission and the Pennsylvania State Police to protect and advance civil rights in the Commonwealth. And we work with local departments to respond to hate crimes when they need assistance. Look, if you experience a hate crime or if someone you represent comes to you, if it's an emergency, obviously call 911. If it's not an emergency, it's important, though, that you report it to local, state, or federal authorities so we have a record of it. You can also contact my civil rights enforcement section in Corbett Anderson there by filling out a complaint on our website, attorneygeneral.gov. As I said, we may be able to help or get you where you need to be to get that help. You should know that we don't usually have jurisdiction in criminal cases that aren't connected to a major criminal enterprise, but we can get you the resources you need and connect you with the law enforcement agency that's appropriate for you. I recognize that now more than ever, leaders must speak and act with moral clarity. We know that hate speech begets hate crimes. Words matter, and hate speech, harassment, intimidation are warning signs. We all have a responsibility to denounce such hate loudly and wherever possible, work together to stop it. So thank you. Thank you for the important work you're doing, and I look forward to seeing you soon.
Thank you, Attorney General Shapiro, and thank you, Governor Wolf. We appreciate your expressions of support for tonight's event and for working with us for a more peaceful, more equitable Pennsylvania. And now I'd like to introduce the director of the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission, Chad Dion Lassiter. It's an understatement to say that Chad has made his mark on that agency in little more than 3 years, the years that he has been at the helm. There is no doubt Chad Dion Lassiter is committed to the fight against extremism, and he is dedicated to advocating for equality and for social justice. Chad.
Hi, I'm Chad Dion Lassiter, the Executive Director of the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission. And though the past year was troublesome and burdensome with a global and historical pandemic, I am elated to say that the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission, we continue to pursue justice for all individuals in our great Commonwealth. Though we were faced with three pandemics, the coronavirus pandemic, the economic pandemic, and the pandemic of hate, or the virus of hate, the Philadelphia Human Relations Commission still continued to take complaints of unlawful forms of discrimination in all 67 counties in our Commonwealth. And with that being said, I want to commend the Philadelphia Regional Office, the Harrisburg Regional Office, the Pittsburgh Regional Office, and the Central Executive Office, as well as our amazing PHRC commissioners. And so when we look at in context where we have been over the past year, as it relates to our democracy, as well as the challenges we've had in the Commonwealth, it's not about have we gotten better, are race relations more fractured? It's what can we do to make sure that we reduce forms of unlawful discrimination. And PHRC, we hear that clarion call every single day. So when Dr. Martin Luther King says that the moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice, we work for the people of the Commonwealth. And what is it that the people of the Commonwealth want? They want justice. Who do the people of the Commonwealth want the justice from? The Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission. And so during this time, we stepped up to the social justice plate with 81 virtual events that dealt with anti-Semitism, that dealt with combating xenophobia, homophobia, transphobia, that dealt with Black Lives Matter. But we also made sure that we engage in a form of race neutrality. We recognize that there are forms of racism that exist on all sides, and there's divisiveness on all sides. And so we also made sure that we recognize that there are law enforcement individuals who put their lives on the line every single day for all of humanity. But make no mistake, in the state of Pennsylvania, we have some challenges. We have white nationalists, we have white supremacists, but we also have a beloved community. That beloved community is comprised of our advisory councils, our human relations commissions, the NAACP, the Urban League, the Anti-Defamation League, and everyday beautiful citizens of our Commonwealth who are standing up to the shadows of hate with truth, love, and kindness. We have an annual report, and we have a beloved community No Hate in Our State report that you can look at for greater details of the amount of cases that we ended up working on, trying our best to bring resolve on behalf of those who trusted us with their experiences around racism and forms of bigotry, prejudice, and discrimination. And you can check that out on our website. As I end, I want to once again thank all of the staff for your dedication over the past year against this global pandemic. You never wavered in your commitment to our mission and to the commitment of justice for all humanity. Thank you.
Thank you, Chad. Chad Dion Lassiter, that was well said. We so appreciate your being here with us and your annual report on the state of peace and justice in Pennsylvania. But now we've come to an exciting moment in our evening, and I have the distinct honor to introduce our keynote speaker, Eddie S. Glaude, Jr. Eddie Glaude is a renowned author and scholar who is actively engaged in helping Americans think through the complex issues now dividing our nation. Dr. Glaude is chair of the Department of African American Studies and a distinguished professor of religious studies at Princeton University. Among his best-known books are Democracy in Black, How Race Still Enslaves the American Soul, and In a Shade of Blue, Pragmatism, and the Politics of Black America. Both books examine issues at the heart of Black communities and the complexities of race and racism in American democracy. But what is most compelling about Eddie S. Glaude Jr. is his openness to dialogue and to civil debate. His ability to listen to opposing views while not shying away from full expression of his own. That's why we invited Dr. Eddie S. Glaude to serve as our keynote speaker for this evening's event. We're confident he will serve as a catalyst for the difficult conversations we must undertake now in our Commonwealth and throughout our nation. May I introduce Eddie S. Glaude, Jr.
Thank you, Sister Joyce, for that gracious introduction. I really appreciate it. I want to thank Brother Chad and all of the unseen labor that's making this event possible, Brother Salim and others. Thank you for what you do. And Brother Chad, thank you for your leadership, your continued dedication to trying to build a more just world, particularly a more just Commonwealth. I want to thank AG Shapiro, Governor Wolf, for their remarks framing our conversation. I'm looking forward to the dialogue, and it's the kind of conversation we need to be having across the country. Oh my goodness, if only we took seriously what a commitment to peace and justice means in these dark times. So what I want to do is to offer kind of some brief remarks, and then we can jump into the conversation. I want to begin with kind of historical touch point. On December 15th, 1763, the Paxton volunteer in the backcountry of Pennsylvania attacked a Conestoga village. They murdered native men, native women and children. They burned the cabins to the ground. The volunteers claimed that the Susquehannocks, who had long ties with the surrounding communities, were in fact secret enemies. John Penn at the time got word of the actions of his fellow white Pennsylvanians, and he called for the perpetrators to be captured and charged with murder. Instead, the volunteers hunted down the native people who had fled to Lancaster, and when they found them there, slaughtered them. Some tried to justify the actions of the men, said that they were young and inflamed by passions. As one said, Sarah Sweetberg said, a wonderful book, Liberty and Insanity in the Age of American Revolution, quote, in order to protect other Indians allied with the Pennsylvania government from these threatening men, colonial officials brought them into Philadelphia, placing in a military barracks defended by British regulars for safety. This act led the volunteer to conclude that quote, their government did not protect the safety and liberty of its own people, but enforced dangerous allegiances with savages who would unleash horrors against backcountry settlers, end quote. 250 or so men decided to march to Philadelphia to confront the government. Ben Franklin was dispatched to meet them. And when he encountered the men, they handed Franklin a petition that claimed the government had ignored their concerns. They didn't express regret or guilt for the murder, the slaughter. Others defended them. One pamphlet entitled, quote, the conduct of the Paxton men impartially represented, suggested that the men hadn't lost their minds, but that their madness, quote, had been driven by the government's good treatment of heathens and traitors. They insisted that their liberty and their lives mattered more than us. Before we were country, men and women mad with the fever of liberty and the belief that their lives mattered more than others, is threatened to pull apart the very fabric of our society. And we see in this story the intimacy of our hatreds, not only towards those who lived among them, traded with them, with whom they had long-lasting friendships, but the intimacy of those who felt a kinship with the murderers, who loved them and defended them no matter monstrous actions. Today we stand on the precipice. The fever, the distorted view of liberty has taken hold, and some of us are willing to throw away this entire experiment in democracy as they cling to a view that ours must remain a white nation, the vein of old Europe. We saw it on January 6th, when a mob of mostly white men and women sacked the Peace House, shouting, "Stop the steal." They were talking about Philadelphia. They were talking about Atlanta. They're talking about Detroit and Milwaukee, places where people of color are voted in large numbers. They insisted that their vote mattered more than the votes of people of color. We see it in the ongoing efforts to delegitimize our electoral process by sowing distrust in electoral election processes and officials. We see it in legislative efforts across the country to enable the rejection of election outcomes that some may disagree with. In other words, we're witnessing in real time an all-out assault on American democracy. And the Commonwealth is on the front lines. We see a deep discord that binds the body politic today. Where hyper-partisanship, which typically tracks along racial lines, reigns. Where public life is so fragmented that it is difficult, if not impossible, to imagine a jointly shared idea of the public good. We are either self-interested persons in pursuit of our own individual aims and ends, or we are members of tribes seeking to own the other. In either case, the idea of a robust conception of the public good impossible to conceive. The intimacies of our hate, kind of free-floating hostility, both have in some ways overwhelmed our sense of community, any sense of community, our sense of obligation to each other. All of this has happened, has happened, against the backdrop of over 700,000 dead. COVID-19 continues to rage, and we continue to bury our dead. Communities hit hard, families brought to their knees. They struggle with the reality that a loved one is gone forever. And COVID has functioned like a blue dye shot through the body politic. It revealed all our vulnerabilities and our sickness. It showed us that the shredding of the social safety net over the last 40 years has left Americans vulnerable, exposed. It has revealed the limits of our healthcare system. We watched essential workers, quote unquote, risk their lives to maintain the food supply chain and deliver goods to those of us who could stay home. We watched the rich get richer while others fought and continued to fight against the living wage of those who saved us. Just think about it. The folks who were considered essential workers are now being characterized as lazy folks who simply want a federal handout. Can you imagine? In so many ways, we have banished our dead from view. Death remains hidden. Modern cemeteries cast out of sight to the distant corners of where we live. In this fabulous book entitled The Republic of Suffering, Drew Fowler wrote about the Civil War. She said, quote, that death created a modern American Union, not just by ensuring national survival, but by shaping enduring national structures and commitments. Death, she writes, inspired self-scrutiny and self-definition. So all we need to do is think of the thousands of Civil War photographs of the dead and what those images forced the nation to remember. This is anathema to our time. We have more images and videos of police killing Black people than we do of the carnage of COVID-19. Today, the dead from coronavirus is principally private affair, where a sense of shared suffering is feeding at best. COVID death has so saturated by our politics, COVID has shown us our disunion, not unity. We are in a moment. An idea of America as a kind of multiracial democracy is under assault. Those who cleave to an idea that ours must be a white nation in the vein of old Europe are stoking hatred, stoking divisions, acting on them, placing lives in peril, and most importantly, or in addition, not more important than lives, but in addition, placing our democracy in peril. Now, what do we have to do in the face of all of this? Where greed and racism and selfishness threaten to overrun the country. What must we do to save our democracy? Well, first, and I say this without a hint of hyperbole, we have to choose is decide. Standing in the middle during this storm will only ensure the collapse of it all. Too much is at stake to do so. The choice is clear here. Either you fight for democracy or you ally yourself with those who stand against it. Now, fighting for democracy will involve finally leaving behind this distorted idea of liberty and the belief that lives ought to be valued more than others. What do I mean by this distorted idea of liberty? Some, right, conflate the idea of liberty and freedom with the idea of selfishness. So it's almost as Ayn Rand has defined liberty for us. That this negative conception of liberty, right, to be left on to one's own devices means matters more than any other principle, right? But this distorted view of liberty combined with this idea that some lives ought to matter more than others, right, is threatened to overwhelm and overrun our democracy. Fighting for democracy will involve all forming a new social and moral contract between us all, establishing a new baseline of what it means to be in community with others. That contract, in my view, should entail a commitment to a broad public infrastructure of care, centered around health, saying that if you get sick, our obligation to each other will mean that we take care of you. Involves a guaranteed quality of life, that if you work 40 hours a week, you can put a roof over your head and put food on the table and send your children to college. No matter the color of your skin or your zip code or who you love or your ability. It means that you can live in safe and secure communities without being over-policed and over-surveilled and subject to a kind of state violence that would leave you mourning the loss of your child or loved one. We need a new social and moral contract that will hold off the hate, that will announce our commitment to each other. And we also have to tell ourselves a different story about who we are. The fever, the madness of distorted liberty, alongside the belief that white people matter more than others, have threatened this democracy before. You don't have to confront that history now. We have to grow up if we're going to save this republic. We have to grow up. We have to confront the intimacy of our hatreds. That on January 6th, it was our sisters and brothers, our mothers and fathers, our uncles and aunts, our best friends, our neighbors, who sacked the Capitol. They believe that liberty and their and that white people, they believe that their liberty and that white people matter more than others. They are threatening the republic. Have to admit that. In the end, Americans are trapped in a history that we refuse to know. But we'll carry with us. The terror and panic we are experiencing now have everything to do with the gap between who we imagine ourselves to be and who deep down we really are. That the nation actively evades confronting this gap locks the country into a kind of perpetual adolescence where those who desperately hold on to the American myth as some kind of new world Eden refuse to grow up. Imagine being stuck forever and never land. Refusing to be responsible, refusing to be held accountable, refusing to grow up. We have to fight for new America. And every time new America is out to be born, in that juxtaposition of January 6th and elections in Georgia, where a southern state, right? Southern state that sought in some ways, right, to imagine a different future for itself. Wow.
sentence, first Jewish sentence, and first African-American sentence. I'm not talking about some ideological commitments. What I'm suggesting is that at the moment in which a new America was trying to be born, another America was clinging to life. Every single time a new America is about to be born, the umbilical cord of white supremacy has been wrapped around the baby's neck. We have to be better midwives. We have to be better midwives. We have to fight for a new America, understanding that everything we do now will determine whether we survive these dark and desperate times. Tell the truth. Be clear in our leadership, as the Attorney General said, and act with a kind of moral clarity. Make your choice. Will you fight for democracy? Will you fight for democracy? Or will you ally yourself with those forces who are trying to destroy? I'm looking forward to the conversation. I'm sorry my AirPods were acting up.
Very much. That was truly profound and gave us a lot to discuss, to think about, and probably from the comments I'm seeing to argue about, to be honest. But let's get right into it. I guess I'll start because I do want to bring in my dear friend Chad, because I know he wants to, and we're privileged to also have with us WITF reporter Anthony Orozco, who is going to join our conversation. But I'm going to play Pollyanna here. Okay, and I'm just going to throw out the first one. I remember growing up in New Orleans, Louisiana. I remember not being able to go into many places. I remember seeing the whites only water fountains. I remember when my grandmother took me by the hand and said, "We can now walk into the Jung Hotel because we're free," right? So I guess what I'm throwing out at you here is, as bad as things look right now, aren't they getting better?
Well, you know, I think this is part of the American fantasy. We want to pat ourselves on the back for incremental change. And generations are actually lost as we congratulate ourselves on these small shifts and tinkering around the edges, as it were. See, the value gap, this belief that some people, because of the color of their skin, matter more than others, the value gap affects the distribution of advantage and disadvantage. And it's going to look differently under different conditions. So what the value gap looked like in the context of slavery, it's going to be very different than what it looked like in the context of Jim Crow. But we still have, under those different material conditions, the distribution of advantage and disadvantage, right? Based upon white people being valued more than others. It's going to look differently. The value gap is going to look differently with a black man in the White House, right? But the reality is that when we look at the data, when you read this report, I can say from my gut, we're going to still see how race continues to animate every aspect of our lives, right? And I think it's important for us not to rush to congratulate ourselves, right? But to continue to fight for a more just America. That's how I would respond. Yeah. But that's not to deny that there's no progress, because my daddy, I grew up in Mississippi on the coast, just an hour and 45 minutes away from New Orleans. My dad couldn't go.
Yeah.
My dad couldn't go to Princeton because Princeton didn't admit a large number of African Americans until the late 60s, early 70s. And here I am, a distinguished professor at Princeton. But that fact doesn't obscure the reality that we're a country still defined by some who are valued and some who are generally devalued.
Now, let me bring my friend Chad into this. Go ahead, Chad.
Yeah, my dear brother Eddie, I would like for you to just expound upon that social contract. As we know, Charles Mills talked about the racial contract. And I've seen this in my role at PHRC from the perspective of when you speak out and you address white supremacy, white violence, white privilege, whiteness, you're looked upon as the person that's divisive, but these things exist in context. So that aspect of what you mentioned as it relates to the social contract, we have a white supremacist problem in the country. And those of us who speak truth to it, we're not the ones that are divisive. So we're quick to attack in context those who speak out against white supremacy and the ideology of something that we didn't create. And so if you could just speak to that, and then the back part of that is, how can we continue to do this work, albeit the racial fatigue and the racial trauma from doing the work, but also having the conversations to continue to verbalize white supremacy to itself?
Sure. Yeah, so it's one of the efficient ways in which America polices, right, how we talk about it. So to name white supremacy or to name racism on a certain view is to somehow give, or is it somehow to be racist? You see, so when we call something white supremacist or we call it racist, the fact that we're using that language itself, according to some, is in fact racist. Now, part of what this is the efficient evasion of how, again, advantage is being distributed. This rhetorical move that the problem isn't, right, the practice of devaluing others based upon skin color, for example. The problem is actually naming the practice of devaluing others. Now, what we have to do is to understand that rhetoric for what it is. We're seeing it right now, and this is a controversial move, in the very ways in which critical race theory is being deployed to teach American history, honestly, right? Somehow to reveal condemn and convict white Americans of evil in some ways, as opposed to just simply telling the truth about how the country came into being. That's why I began my talk with the story I began with, where there are people invoking liberty as a justification for monstrous acts, and then complaining when they're being held to account for it. And they're complaining in the name of liberty, right? And so part of the work that we have to do is to understand how that rhetoric works as a mode of a way of trying to contain, Brother Chad, how we get this out in the open, right? And let me be very clear. This is not just, I'm not just referring to conservative voices. In Manhattan, not too long ago, there was an attempt by the chancellor to desegregate schools in Manhattan. And many of us saw these town hall meetings where white liberals were screaming about how their schools were going to be compromised by this, that they were going, so they're a loud racist and then they're quiet. And the challenge is to figure out how to get at that in a very detailed way, because the loud racists are easy to identify. It's the quiet silence, and that cuts across ideological divides, that allow it to happen, because I just don't want you to mess with my neighborhood. I don't want you to mess with my school. I don't want you to mess with my property, right? And so the value gap, this belief that some people matter more than others, is sustained not just simply by loud races, by those who are complicit with those loud people. I hope that's a way of getting at it.
Yeah, it is.
I want to bring Anthony into the conversation. Anthony, you've been hearing all of this, and I'm sure you've got some questions. Go ahead.
Well, for questions, I don't have any that pop up my mind other than how I'm on the same bar as you intellectual giants. You put that beautifully, Dr. But I will say that that white supremacy is, and dismantling white supremacy is an objective, a job, a duty, a moral obligation for white people who benefit from the privilege. I am blessed, cursed with a chameleon appearance. There are rooms that I'm in where people do not know my ethnic background or my racial makeup. And I have been privy to things. I've seen how people move and operate and discuss when they think they are in a room with peers and no one else. And so I have been privileged to see that from the inside and to know what white supremacy really looks like, to know what it is like to benefit from white supremacy, from my, you know, very white appearance. And we have a moral obligation to confront it. It's hard for many people to see that, to understand that they've gained privilege from just their appearance. And by privilege, of course, I mean just not having the assumption that they're guilty or that they are less intelligent. And that requires some very hard conversations like we're having tonight. And it's hard for people to open up to that because sometimes they feel that being uncomfortable is synonymous with being unsafe. And those are two different things. Yeah. And so I think as a country, we need to get very comfortable with being uncomfortable.
Well, we're there. We're definitely there with uncomfortable. But Anthony, why don't you tell them you have a Latino background. Is that correct?
Yes.
You're so a Latin Affairs reporter for WITF. So tell them a little bit about your background.
Yes. So I'm the Latino Communities reporter for WITF. My father came to this country in the early 80s from Mexico. He was a very dark, half-indigenous Mexican. My mother is, I like to say, about as white as a paper plate. Family has been here since before the American Revolution. And so I come with that mixed heritage, that mixed background. I also want to thank Dr. Glaude for acknowledging the original nations that were here before us all. So that's my racial makeup, my ethnic makeup. And I report on the communities that we see growing here in all of the cities across the Commonwealth. And that's primarily Latino communities, immigrant communities, people who come to this country with hope and a dream. And I think this speaks to the original point that we touched on earlier, that there is a reason why people come here in droves. There is a reason why people come to America, because it's a shining light in the world. But that does not mean that there is not polishing to do, that there is deep work done.
Well, very, very well said. And I guess, Dr. Glaude, I want to, you know, let you comment. Do you feel that there truly is enough synergy, let's put it that way, or camaraderie amongst these ethnic groups with Latinos and Blacks working together, or are we seeing fissures there as well?
I think, of course. I mean, I think there are moments where we see convergence of interests. I mean, when we think about the presidential election, when we think about the senatorial special elections in Georgia, and we see interest convergence, as Derek Bell would say, evidence itself very clearly. But there, you know, I think it's very important for us not to kind of flatten out the differences within these particular communities. The way in which race makes itself known within Latin communities, Latinx communities, is very clear. The way in which immigrant communities kind of inhabit America's racial logic is very, we need to be very, very clear about that. Anti-Semitism can evidence itself across these racial divides. We need to be mindful of that. There's the sense of community. Our relationship to each other has broken down very clearly. We don't have, as I said in the talk, we don't have a robust conception of the good, because for the last 40 years, and I'm thinking about an ideology since 1980, that has in some ways transformed us from being citizens in communion with each other to being self-interested persons in pursuit of our own aims and ends. And so we retreat into our silos, whether it's our neighborhoods, whether it's our echo chambers when it comes to information, whether it's our political tribe, and we only are concerned about the folks within those spaces. And then our relationship to folks who are not in those spaces is often one that's hostile. So there's a kind of free-floating hostility that defines the Republic in this moment. And then, I wanted to emphasize this again, the intimacy of our hatreds. We want to think about hatred as abstract, uh-huh. right? The reason why it sustains itself is because it's evidenced by people we love. When you hear your mother or your father spout hatred, when you see your brother or your uncle do what they do, it becomes very difficult to mobilize the resources to call them to account. And so people want to run past it. Not because they're loyal simply to Donald Trump, not because they're loyal to any particular ideology alone. These may be reasons, but there's an intimacy here. And the language I use is, you know, James Baldwin would say, the slave master knew that he was selling his child. Mm-hmm. Or they understood. We think about slavery as some kind of abstract notion. No. The people around them, they knew their names. They knew their hair color. They knew their tics. They knew what they were. There's an intimacy to this that we have to wrap our minds around. That's why it's so intense in its violence. It's so intense in how it manifests itself. So we have to be mindful of that as we think about it.
Dad, I know you want to jump in there. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to provide a comment, and I think we should go to some of the Q&A that we have in the chat. But, you know, just the way Eddie just framed that out, I think that we sometimes forget about the contemporary moment. We're thinking of white nationalism from the historical aspect of white sheets, right? And when you look at Charlottesville, those were our pediatricians, our doctors, our lawyers, our Sunday school teachers. These were our teachers. These were individuals who, from an identity perspective, could be someone that's sitting next to us in a cafeteria. Could be someone that we know intimately. To Eddie's point, these are individuals. And so when we're looking at racial identity and racial socialization, if you're socialized to hate people because of LGBT status, because of, you know, they're Jewish, or because they're African-American, or because they're from a rural part of the Commonwealth, then that socialization finds itself creeping into the context of what you're doing on a day-to-day basis, right? And so this notion for us at the PHRC, we're very intentional and strategic in the work that we do, because we all come to a context with a pretext and an ism. It doesn't make us bad people. So for me as a male, 6'6", I always am being mindful of male privilege, of toxic masculinity. But I'm also aware of the size that I carry, that I'm a threat to people because of no other reason than the birth of a nation, D.W. Griffith's racial viewpoint of looking at individuals. And so when Eddie talks about, and you know, just let me just say, God bless you, brother, and thank you for all you do for our democracy, because I think we have to have these frank conversations. We can't just automatically, like we did when Obama became the president, we're post-racial, when we know post-racial is a mirage. We didn't roll up our sleeves. We didn't dismantle systemic and structural racism, educational apartheid, environmental racism, economic injustice. And I think that we're so quick to want to get away from the conversations that, and that's the part I was talking about with the racial fatigue and the racial trauma, because we're doing the work. And then those of us who bear the brunt of all of this experience that's in our DNA, it becomes a form of vicarious traumatization as we're continuing to do the work and try to make sense of it. It's not, I'll end by simply saying, when you look at the context of Kaepernick, he takes a knee, peaceful, didn't do anything to anyone. Derek Chauvin takes a knee on George Floyd's neck, kills George Floyd, but Kaepernick is the problem. Even tonight, when we leave this space, Executive Director Lassiter is going to be the problem for calling out white supremacy. Mm-hmm. How can you work in a space that is civil rights and human rights and not have conversations around civil rights and human rights. And I know it's nuanced because sometimes you have people who are opinionated and not informed. And so hopefully what we take away from tonight is the things that Dr. Glaude is leaving us with so that we can become informed. And it's not just my opinion that America has a white nationalist problem or white supremacy problem. It's a diseased democracy. The data, qualitative and quantitative, along all of the protected categories that we work with at PHRC, speaks to that. The books that Dr. Glaude writes and, you know, and multiple others, these books are not books that are just imagining. It's not perceived racism. We have racism in our democracy, structurally, systemically, and otherwise.
And there are three things that he's mentioned here that I think I want to zero in on, and then I want to look at some of the comments there. But selfishness as equal to liberty. That, to me, was profound, because that's what we're seeing. At one time, you would have been embarrassed to say you didn't care if you spread a disease to an old lady and it killed her, right? Now it's my freedom to do that. That's your problem. It's not mine. The other thing is we have to grow up and we have to fight for our America. Now, I say this, I want, because I'd like to hear us all kind of engage on this, because, and we've gotten in the chat here, all lives matter. Remember, there's that division on Black Lives Matter and all lives matter and human lives matter. And so you see how this is dividing us. But at the same time, you have called us all to fight for this America. I do see people fighting. I actually see white people fighting. I get letters all the time, you know, from people saying they don't like what's happening to this party, or they don't like the lies that are being thrown out. So I see it happening. And yet more needs to be done. I think that's the message you're telling us. This is the time. If you're going to be out there, you need to be out there now. You can't be quiet, right? Yeah. Are you at all encouraged at the people who are having the difficult conversations and the people who are reading The White Fragility? And I mean, is that at all encouraging?
Of course, absolutely. You know, Baldwin says that hope is invented every day. And if you have to invent hope every day, that means you have to hold off despair every day. So to see Americans moving, trying desperately to understand what we need to do in order to imagine ourselves otherwise, that's really key. But our tendency, because we're adolescent in our orientation, is to celebrate the effort. I tried. I needed an A, Doc. I tried to write the paper. I know it wasn't good, but at least I tried. That's not the point. Right? So part of what I'm trying to get us to see is that we're at a crossroads, to use a blues metaphor, right? Where the nation has to make a choice. What kind of republic are we going to be? The demographic shifts are happening. The anxiety that has been unleashed because of those demographic shifts are evident. The choice has to be made. Now, those people who say all lives matter, empirically, we know that's not true. But that doesn't matter to that claim, right? I can show you the data that literally rebukes the claim that all lives matter. I can do it with regards to mortality rates. I could do it with regards to healthcare. I could do it with regards to employment. I could do it with regards to housing. I could tell you a story that inequality in the United States didn't just happen by happenstance. It is the result of policy. If you talk about the wealth gap in the country, just really quickly, I know we got to get to some of these folk over here, because I've been reading the comments, getting right? So when you think about the wealth gap in this country, at the very moment in which the vaunted American middle class came into existence through New Deal policy, Black folk were locked out. We couldn't gain access to it. They even barred the labor market that we were principally located in, the agricultural sector and the domestic sector. When you think about banking, redlining, who got access to FHA mortgages? We couldn't get it. Redlining, which devalued our homes. The wealth gap was deliberately created through policy. You think about the achievement gap, segregated schools, Some schools in the United States are as segregated today as they were in 1968, having everything to do with housing policy, residential policy. Think about criminal justice. We can go down the line. We built the country true. And the only way we're going to remedy it is that we have to admit it, that we built this. And we have to be as deliberate in dismantling it as we were in creating it. But see, that's hard to say. It's hard to do when you are content to believe a lie. When you are content to believe a lie. And that's what we have to try to pierce through. Because we know it's not true that all lives matter in this country. Let me put it this way, all lives should matter. Mm. And when we say Black Lives Matter, let me just be very, very clear. When people say Black Lives Matter, they're not saying that because we need to assert that we matter. We know we matter. We know we matter. We're saying in that slogan that white lives should matter more than any other life.
And we have to say it. We have to at least be able to say it. But here's something. Let's zero in. What Pennsylvania have to offer a modern world? Someone is writing. Crawl back into your villages, Ella. So you brought up also that you think Pennsylvania is key in this divided nation. We clearly were a battleground state. But what role do you see Pennsylvania, places like this, that we are central Pennsylvania, it's pretty white. What do you think could happen here that could be a model for the rest of the world?
Absolutely. I mean, I think, you know, from my own vantage point, Pennsylvania can evidence it through policy, a social and moral contract that announces a different way in which we are to live together. That there is a baseline quality of life that every Pennsylvanian has in the Commonwealth, no matter your zip code, no matter the color of your skin. There's a basic obligation evidenced in policy that the Commonwealth announces when it comes to healthcare, when it comes to education, right? When it comes to not law and order, but safety and security, where the Commonwealth can bridge the divide between Pittsburgh and Philadelphia. Mm.
That's a big divide.
It's a huge divide. And what the Commonwealth did for our democracy, as people are calling for audits in the name of the big lie, and it is a lie. We need to be very clear about it. And I'm not advocating for any particular political figure or nothing like that. What I'm saying very explicitly is that there has to be courageous leadership, right, to stand in the breach as these illiberal forces are using the democratic process to undo it. Because we've always been, and I should say this really quickly, this is why Pennsylvania is a battleground. It's an incredibly important space as we move into 2022 and 2024. We've always in the United States faced illiberal forces. Over 600,000 people died in the battle between those illiberal forces and those who were trying to defend the Republic. There's always been those who believed that this country belonged only to certain folk. Remember, America didn't become a genuinely multiracial democracy until after 1965. That's hard to digest. Prior to that moment, it was a herringbone democracy, as they say in the Academy, right? Mm-hmm. So these illiberal forces have been a part of our battle because America is more than just simply an idea. America is an argument. And the Commonwealth can stand on the front lines of that argument because we had political actors who said no to those illiberal forces. And as they are passing legislation across the country, not just simply to disenfranchise and suppress the vote, but to undo the democratic process, if the outcome is not consistent with their desires, the Commonwealth is on the front lines of that battle.
Yes, it is. And, you know, but even more than that, and I'm going to bring in Anthony to this again, even more than that, it's a personal battle. I mean, what you described, this intimacy, this being able to look at your uncle and say, "Uncle, you're wrong." What you were describing, Anthony, in personal interactions where they didn't know you weren't necessarily just like them, right? That you had a different heritage. That takes personal courage. It's hard to step up, especially, I guess, if you're just not used to, not one of those fighters all the time. It's hard to step up and do that. What do you think about that, Anthony? How would you manage?
Well, when you live a life of privilege, equality feels like oppression. And it feels like you're under attack whenever equality emerges or there is any effort towards equality. And people get really uncomfortable about that fact. They want their own struggles and difficulties to be validated, which they are, but they do not want to address something that may make them uncomfortable, that may, you know, rustle them out of their slumber of understanding what this country was built on, how it operates, and who it gives preferential treatment. There's two points also that I just want to comment on quickly. That you, the idea of bridges between communities of color. In the Latino community, there is a very interesting paradox that happened. When you look at Latinos and you can say, point somebody out of the room and say, that person's Mexican, well, why? Many times it's because there are many mixed race people in Latin America of European indigenous descent and also Latino. And we have races already mixed in to Latinos. Our ethnic group is full of diversity. We are still profoundly racist. There are Latinos who will deny day and night that they have African blood in them. There are Latinos who want to appear more European, and that's because of the system that our culture is built. That is something that is innate in our cultures in Latin America, and something that Latinos have to address themselves. And in this past year, while there was a racial reckoning that swept the nation, there was also one that happened within the Latino community where people had to address anti-Blackness, and we should say that, you know, that well, by name, very specific type of racism, anti-Black, wanting to distance themselves. And I think in the communities that we have here, we have an opportunity. When you talk about what Pennsylvania can bring, when we see these communities that are growing and changing, as the doctor noted, that demographics are already set. The future is coming. The kids are going to have color. That's just how it is already. And we have the opportunity for people to not just address what's in themselves, but to empathize, which all great storytelling does. That's where I come from. You know, the story of journalism, the field of journalism, is trying to get people to understand and to see other people's lives. Well, the next generations that follow us won't have a choice. They will be of mixed blood, and they will have to deal with that in themselves.
That's the issue that I think many people have brought up, that we are at a turning point, whether we like it or not. The facts are we're becoming a more racially mixed society, period. And minorities are becoming to the fore. The white majority is not going to have the sheer numbers of power. That clearly is behind some of this. Am I right, Dr. Glaude?
I think so. And it's also the case that we've lived under a political ideology that has really shifted the resources from everyday working people to the rich and the extremely rich. And so more of us are economically vulnerable. White working class folk are trying desperately to figure out how to make ends meet. They're trying to figure out how to send their kids to college. They're busting their behinds to keep a roof over their heads and keep food on the table. This inequality that defines the country. Remember when Alan Greenspan left the Federal Reserve, he said the most dangerous thing facing the Republic was income inequality. Barack Obama turned around when he left after his 8 years, said the same thing. And so when you have this class divide, which is tied to greed, right, which has everything to do with a political ideology that eviscerated the public, any robust conception of the public good, that transferred dollars from hardworking people to rich folk, it becomes very difficult to imagine our relationship to each other, right? So what you get are, problem is big, bad government putting its thumb on the scale to allow these black folk to jump ahead of us, to allow these brown folk to jump ahead of us. And then you have the kind of cultural dimensions, right? We're still fighting the battles of the post-60s era, kind of cultural war 5.0. We're in the midst of it because people aren't quite sure. What I had a colleague of mine said, what is this Indigenous Peoples America Day? What the hell is that? The older guy, right? Yeah. He didn't wrap his mind around it. So the country is shifting and the ground beneath folks' feet feels like quicksand. And folk are reaching for something that can give them some sense of stability. Young folk, just really quickly, young folk are members of what I call the catastrophic generation. Millennials and Gen Zers and Gen Yers, they come of age, right? Global recession, planet screaming, pandemic, mass murders. They know the country's broken. Some are reaching
in their school.
Exactly. Some are reaching for new languages. We have to reimagine America. But remember, Dylann Roof is not a baby boomer.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is that some are reaching for old languages. The language of fascism. They're reaching for older because we're in this moment of transition. And all of us are unsettled. So we fall back onto our comfort zones. And of course, our hatreds and fears. And here we are.
Here's a comment that I think we'll find interesting. History shows, says Christine, not only people of color were slaves in America. Now, she does say this. Not only people of color were slaves in America. She says Irish, English. We need to learn by mistakes and move on. I don't dwell on the color of our skin. I treat people as humans. And all of us should do the same. Help one another and work together. Chad, you want to take that one on?
I'm going to let Eddie take that.
All right. Go ahead, Eddie. Tosses it to you.
I think it's really important for us to understand how colorblindness can actually reproduce inequality. If you have a society that has been built on racial prejudices, with the idea that some people, because of the color of their skin, ought to be valued more than others, if my description is true, that housing policy was shaped by race, labor markets shaped by race, education shaped by race, and then suddenly you become colorblind, then you can't speak directly to the ways in which race have distributed advantage and disadvantage. You leave in place, right? Colorblindness then becomes this insidious way of keeping the board as it is, right? Remember I said we have to be as deliberate in our remedy as we were in trying to create it. Now look, you always get this thing. Of course there were indentured servants. Toni Morrison writes about this in Beloved. She writes about this in Mercy. At that moment, Amy Denver, this poor white girl, is the one who gives birth to Denver, who saves Setha's life in the novel Beloved. And Morrison is trying to give us, in that little moment, right, insight into the complexity, right, of vulnerability at that moment. But the invocation of indentured servitude as a way of turning our eyes away from the horror of slavery and its afterlife, right, is morally suspect. colorblindness in a society that is still vexed by color is morally suspect. And I want to be very, very clear about that, right? Because it whether it's purposeful or whether it's deliberate, it ends up reproducing the kinds of evils that we're trying to rid ourselves of.
Or it ends up maintaining the status quo, which is not helping Black people or brown people, right?
Brown people, I mean, or white. Yeah. You know, these categories, as Jimmy Baldwin says, these categories trap us, right? They trap us. They are our iron cage, right? But that doesn't mean we have to suddenly not see difference. I don't want, how can I put this? I'm a Black man from Mississippi. I don't want you not to see me and the power of the tradition out of which I come. That's not what I'm aspiring for. What I want is a society where I can be. You see the difference? Mm-hmm. For you not to see me is a problem. But the condition for my entree into your world is that I have to leave the particularity of me at the door. That's the problem. I want to live in a society where I can be fully me.
That's right.
Without bearing the burden of folk being afraid or hating me.
Yeah, Very well said. This has been quite a conversation. I would like to really thank Anthony Orozco from WITF. Thank Chad Dion Lassiter for being a part of this provocative conversation. And it will be provocative, Chad. You can get ready.
I
feel for you, brother.
Yeah.
Don't worry, we're here for you.
For some much needed prayer, Doc. But
I just wanted to say before
we conclude that we see things differently. You know, I just saw the last comment in the chat where someone said, why is it always about blame? And that person is certainly entitled to their context. I don't think anything this evening was about victimization or blame. I think I know Eddie and I come out of that tradition that produced Cornel West, W.E.B. Du Bois, and multiple others, where we're just in that same vein of the civil rights, speaking truth to power with love, truth, and kindness, right? W.E.B. Du Bois wrote about the great John Brown, right? Harriet Tubman and William Still had multiple white individuals helping them with regards to the Underground Railroad. And so America seduces us into the black-white binary that has us choosing sides. But the reality is, I don't see anything that we spoke about. And I respect Nicole, who I don't know. I don't think we talked about blame. I think we have talked about solutions. And I think that the self-introspection of what Eddie laid out for us will lend us to figure out what part we want to play in the solutions of reimagining a new bridge in our democracy, right? And so there's no call of action and you know, per se, this evening. Each person has to do what they need to do. And I think it's always good and convenient to start with yourself. We always talk about racism that someone else has. What about the portraits of racism that David T. Wellman talked about? What about the way that we engage in forms of xenophobia within ourselves? Change ourselves, but make no mistake, I'm inspired by what you provided, my dear brother, because it's on a structural level. For me, it's a macro level. It's systemic and it's structural. You calling me the N-word doesn't mean anything, but if your policy, it means something, but if your policy is giving me the end treatment with regards to housing, public accommodations, commercial property, I can't get a job. I have 2 degrees from the University of Penn and someone else has no degree and they have a criminal record and they'll get the job. That's the systemic and structural aspect that you framed out. My dear brother, love you, man, with an agape love, with an agape love.
There's so much more we could explore, but of course we really are out of time. And then we still have to honor, but I want to really thank Dr. Glaude. And frankly, I want to repeat your clarion call there. We have to work together to save America. It's too precious. We love our homeland too much to let it go by the way, to lose this wonderful experiment that is America. So with that, I thank you all. And we now are at this special moment that will culminate our evening. We would like to pay tribute to the extraordinary work of the field offices of the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission. The dedicated staff of the PHRC are on the front lines of our battle against extremism. to document civil rights abuses and worse, document hate crimes and harassment. It is sad to report work has only gotten more vital and more demanding in the past 2 years. In the first half of 2021, HRC staff investigated 23% more cases of hate crimes and harassment than in 2020. That's an average of 205 cases each month. And it's important to note in 2020, the caseload was higher even than in 2018 and 2019, 13% higher. Since July 1st of this year, a total of 717 cases of hate crimes or harassment have been filed. There's no doubt PHRC staff have much work to do, and our Commonwealth is depending upon them to do it well and to protect us all. This is why PennLive and the Patriot News are taking this time to acknowledge the work of the field offices of the PHRC, even as we fervently hope for the day when my dear friend Chad and the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission will no longer be needed, will no longer need to exist. So accepting PennLive's tribute this evening is Laura Arjenbright, PHRC Communication Director. Laura.
Thank you. On behalf of Executive Director Chad Dion Lassiter and all of the staff at the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission, we just want to say thank you for recognizing our efforts. You know, across the state in regional offices in Pittsburgh, Philadelphia, and Harrisburg, these folks work tirelessly to eradicate discrimination across the state. And this year has been particularly tough. In the past year or more, we've been dealing with Black Lives Matter, with Asian American, Pacific Islander hate incidents, and of course, everything that COVID has brought. So these guys work day in and day out to be here for the residents of Pennsylvania. But I think it would be better if we hear from them about the work that they do on a daily basis. So I'd like for you to take a minute and watch this brief video. Again, thank you.
We are often a voice for people who do not have a voice.
The work for the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission is vital. Our mission is to eradicate discrimination in the Commonwealth.
For people that are being discriminated against because of color or race or age, religion, national origin.
Here at PHRC, we are able to investigate their cases. And if they have been discriminated against, we are able to provide them remedy that they would not have gotten without our help.
Inclusivity is not a simple task. It's large and it's broad and it's expansive, and there are people that don't understand it.
The PHRC work is not only to be reactive and find justice for those who've been discriminated against, but to be proactive and teach some of the ways that discrimination might occur to the agencies, whether it's intentional or unintentional.
Our goal is just to make sure that justice is served and that both parties have an opportunity to air their differences and reach an agreement that will be beneficial to both.
When somebody believes they've been discriminated against and you're able to have the case investigated and bring it to some peaceful, amicable resolution between the complainant, that's a reward.
After you've been discriminated against, oftentimes you don't know where to turn, and I want the PHRC to be the first name on everyone's list.
Hi, I'm Burke Noel, Vice President of Content at the PA Media Group. Thank you for joining us for the Peace and Justice Report. We hope you found tonight's program engaging and thought-provoking. I'd like to thank our sponsors, Wise Markets, PSECU, and WITF for making this event possible. And of course, a special thanks to the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission, Governor Tom Wolf, Attorney General Josh Shapiro, and of course, our keynote speaker, Dr. Eddie Glaude. Until we meet again, have a wonderful evening.